You ready, Kevin? All right, so now we have the contrarian talk for the day, where there's some competing technologies that maybe says you don't need GraphQL. So we'll see a compelling talk, I've seen it before, compelling talk about Vulcain. Is that pronounced correctly?
Vulcain? Mm-hmm. Yeah. In French, we say Vulcain, but Vulcain, it will be okay.
Vulcain, sounds good. All right, so I'll give him a few minutes here to get his machine set up. Everybody feeling good? Get a little stretch out. All that mind blown from the serverless AWS. Stretch a little bit, yeah? All right. Let's see if we get the HDMI
yes.
in here.
I will.
I'm so jealous of your dongle-free life. Looks promising. Maybe promising. Something's flickering. Mm-hmm. This projector has really given us a lot of suspense today with the talks. We need some like suspense music in the background, some kind of a Twilight Zone. Is Twilight Zone a thing in France? Was it a thing in France? Very good.
Bonjour, c'est détecté, mais...
I would say don't attempt to adjust your TV set, but in that case, it might be actually helpful. All right, very good. So, one more hand of applause.
Good morning. So, this talk is not really a bit about GraphQL, but we will speak a bit about GraphQL anyway. So it's Vulcain in French, but you can say Vulcain, it's good enough. My name is Kevin, I live in Lille, so it has been difficult to get in Paris because of the strike. Sorry about that, I should have spoken yesterday, I'm here today. Anyway, I work at letiel.coop, it's difficult to say in English too, but it means the lime tree. I'm the creator of Vulcain, another protocol called Mercure, we will speak a bit about it, and of a framework written in PHP called API Platform. I'm also a maintainer of the Symfony PHP framework. Who is using Symfony in this room? Okay, nice. You can follow me using my last name as handle on GitHub, Twitter, and on Mastodon. And who is already using Mastodon, the social network? Some of you. Okay, I hope that at the end of this talk, you will start to use Mastodon and that you will understand why it matters. So, letiel.coop, the lime tree, it's a company that provides professional services around APIs, cloud computing, PHP, JavaScript, Go, and many programming languages. It's a special company because it's a self-managed company. It's a worker cooperative. It means that the company belongs entirely to the employees. All the decisions are made democratically between all the employees, and all the money is shared equally in the end of the year. This is a shortened version of this talk. There is a full version of 40 minutes, so it will be too long for today. But you can find the full talk by flashing this QR code on or by going to my website. And there are extra slides in this version that are interesting, but it will be too short for today. So, I know that it's a GraphQL track, but who in this room knows what REST is? Are you sure about that? So REST, basically, is a dissertation that has been written by Roy Fiedling, and REST was developed primarily as a means for communicating web concepts, as we wrote the HTTP 1 and 1.1 specification. It means that REST is the architectural model of the web itself. It's not a way to design web APIs, it's how the web has been designed in the first step, in first. And then, we created something called RESTful Web Services. And RESTful Web Services are a way to implement the REST concepts and the REST architectural pattern for web services. But when you are browsing an HTML website, and when you are clicking on a link on this HTML page going to another website, you are using an implementation of the REST architectural style, that is the web. REST, this architectural style, from the beginning has some performance issues and considerations. First, the first thing to understand is that REST has been designed from the ground up for performance. But REST is a way to create hypermedia system at internet scale. And the performance system of REST has been designed to work at internet scale. And mostly, the REST performance mechanism is using cache mechanisms. So in the HTTP protocol, that is an implementation of the REST pattern. There are several caching strategies that are available, including validation cache and many HTTP headers that you can use to store the data, the resources in cache, both in your own information system, using what we call gateway servers, but also client-side, in the information system of the client, or in the web browser directly. You have two types of caches. Even if REST has been designed from the ground up for performance at internet scale, it has some performance issues. The well-known performance issues for GraphQL developers, and one that GraphQL tried to fix, is the under-fetching problem. It means that, in this example, I'm using a social network, let's say something like Mastodon. And I want to display on a mobile application, for instance, the data of the user, then the posts of this user, and then the followers of this user. In REST, I will have relations between resources. So first, I will have to fetch the data of the user, wait for it, then fetch the related data, wait for it, and then fetch the other related data. And it will increase the latency. The user experience will not be good. Another problem is that a strategy that can be used is to trick REST, to do something that is not very clean, but that works, is to create a single URL that will contain all the data that is needed. So the user and his posts and the related his friends, for instance. But then maybe that it's the appropriate data for the desktop application, but on mobile, you don't want to display all these data. So you will fetch them, but you will not display them, you will not use them. This is another performance problem called the over-fetching problem. GraphQL is an alternative to REST that does a lot of things, but if you go on the GraphQL.org website, the main point of GraphQL is to fix the over and the under-fetching problem. It's a query language allowing to query and to fetch exactly what you need, all what you need, and only what you need. Do we agree on that? Okay. GraphQL has been created before the HTTP/2 protocol. And the main feature of the HTTP protocol, the HTTP/2 protocol, is to make the web faster. And to do that, there are a lot of new features that have been introduced in this protocol, including the ability to compress headers, the ability the protocol is now a binary protocol. There are a lot of features, but one very interesting feature that wasn't available in HTTP/1 is the ability to send and to receive resources in parallel. It's what we call the multiplexing now with HTTP/2, with a single TCP connection. The browser, the client, will be able to send as many HTTP requests in parallel as needed, and to download as many HTTP responses as needed in parallel. It means that with HTTP2, you don't need to nest documents, to unbutton documents, to do tricks that are against the REST paradigm. Another very interesting capability of the HTTP2 protocol is a new feature called the HTTP2 server push. Usually, in HTTP1, when you go on a web page, the web browser will start by downloading an HTML page, then it will pass the HTML, it will detect that a JavaScript file and a CSS file and a picture is needed for the first paint, for the first rendering. And at this point, it will start downloading these dependencies and it will use them when they will be downloaded. With HTTP2 server push, there is another option. You, as a web developer, you know that for the first rendering, both the HTML file, but also the JavaScript file, the CSS file, and the picture must be downloaded. So, ahead of time, the web server can push all the data that are needed for the first rendering to the client. And at this time, in parallel, thanks to the multiplexing capability of the HTTP2 protocol, both resources will be sent by the web server to the browser. When the browser will start parsing the HTML file, it will detect that it needs a JavaScript file. The JavaScript file will be already there and will be used instantly. So it's a way to reduce latency. HTTP2 is new, but it's already supported by 95% of internet users and all major web servers at least. So you can use it right now for everybody. And for the 5 remaining persons, there is transparent fallback to HTTP1 for both web browsers and web servers. Who is already using HTTP2 in production? Okay, it's time to migrate because HTTP3, that will use UDP instead of TCP, is already being standardized and has been implemented in both Chrome and Firefox. So before starting to use HTTP3, use HTTP2. Vulkan will use the capabilities of HTTP2. Vulkan, it's 2 main things. The first thing is, let's say, a tiny web protocol that has been contributed to the IETF as an open standard. It's an internet draft currently that introduces 2 new HTTP headers to fix the underfetching and the overfetching problem. It's also a reference implementation of this tiny protocol written in Go that is a free software that you can use instantly to turn any existing web API, and especially a REST API, even if it's not really mandatory, in a Vulkan-enabled one. Basically, the idea is to use the multiplexing capabilities and the server push capabilities of HTTP2. Here, this API is the Mastodon API, the social network. It's a real API that you can use, that you are using, if you create an account on the Mastodon social network, federated social network. So, on Mastodon, there is a page called Outbox, a resource, with your data, basically. And with relations, it's an hypermedia API. You can see that the IDs are URLs with relations to your activities. And the activities themselves have relations to the statuses. So basically, you need to download all these data to display the things that must be displayed by the mobile application. Usually, you will need to create a first request to this JSON document, fetch it, and then detect the relations, then fetch those ones, then detect the relations, then fetch those ones, and the latency will be huge, and the application will be slow. Vulkan introduces a new HTTP header called Preload. With this header, you can pass a selector. It can be for JSON documents, JSON pointer. It can also be XPath for XML documents. You can negotiate and detect the selector if you want to. And here you will pass, let's say, a kind of a regular expression, a selector. hinting the server of all the relations that you will need. So here I say that I want everything in the ordered items key, so everything with a relation here. And for this, for all these relations because of the star, I want what is pointed by the object key, okay? And so in a single request, an API supporting the Vulkan protocol will send the slash outbox response, but also in parallel, ahead of time and instantly, all the related activities and all the related statuses. To use this and to use HTTP2 server push in JavaScript, it's very easy. It's actually easier than using Apollo with GraphQL because you have nothing specific to do. You can just use fetch, for instance. You pass this header, and then you wait for the JSON document. Actually, you will just wait for this one, the first one. And then you pass the JSON document. You detect the relations. And for every relations, you call fetch again. But when you will call fetch at this point, the data will already be in cache, in a specific cache supported by all modern web browsers called the HTTP2 push cache. So instantly, when you will call fetch here, the data will already be there, and it will be the function will return instantly. So you fix the underfetching problem thanks to HTTP2 at the HTTP level, at the protocol level. So with Vulkan, as with GraphQL, no more underfetching and the N plus one problem. Unlike GraphQL, because every relations are standalone resources, all these resources can be downloaded in parallel. So actually, it will be faster than with GraphQL, because GraphQL allows to create a big JSON document, but the big JSON document cannot be downloaded in parallel, obviously. Here, you have a lot of small documents that can be downloaded in parallel. Also, it allows to use the standard HTTP cache, including, for instance, the cache of the web browser itself, or the cache of a Varnish server, or something like that, all the HTTP cache tools that are existing. And you can have a specific cache for every small resources that you will download, for the outbox, and for the statuses, and for every activity. With GraphQL, you need to use a specific application layer cache, both client-side and server-side. You cannot use the capabilities of the protocol of HTTP itself. So one of the main benefits of Vulkan over GraphQL is that it's just a REST API. And so you can use all the capabilities of the HTTP protocol, because HTTP is implementing the REST architectural style. You can also use the authorization mechanism of the protocol, content and language negotiation, the ability to add new HTTP headers to fit your needs. The other HTTP header that has been created in Vulkan is called fields. With fields, you can filter the responses generated by the API, so you can fix the overfetching problem. Let's say that on my mobile app, I don't want the full JSON documents, but only some keys for every relations. So I can pass as many fields header as I need and select, cherry pick exactly what properties of the JSON documents, including by traversing relations, I need. And then I will get only what I need, exactly as with GraphQL, but all the benefits of using a plain old REST API. The Vulkan Gateway Server is a reference implementation of the Vulkan protocol that is open source, that you can use on any existing web API to support these two new HTTP headers. Actually, it's not the only implementation, because there is a competing implementation that already has been created. The protocol is some months old, and the other implementation has been created by Adobe, so you can find it on the Adobe namespace on GitHub. But with this one, you have a standalone server that you can put in your existing infrastructure to turn your API in a Vulkan API in just a few minutes. We also provide Docker images and a Kubernetes chart if you want to use that. It's a Go binary, so it's very, very easy to use. You download the binary, you set in an environment variable the URL of your upstream API, and then you can use the two new HTTP headers, the preload and the fields once. In all the example, I am using a REST level 3, according to the Richardson maturity level, API. It means hypermedia APIs. All the identifiers of the resources are URLs, the relations between the resources are URLs, and all the controls of the API, the pagination, the filters that you can apply, are exposed in the JSON document itself. It's a best practice in the world of the REST APIs to create hypermedia APIs, but who has in his information system a REST APIs at the level 3 of the Richardson maturity level using URLs as nice, but you are the only one. Okay. With Vulkan, you can also map an existing legacy API that is using plain old identifiers like integers for the relations. Here I have a book. And the book has a relation to an author document, but it's not an explicit relation using HTTP headers. So I can int the Vulkan Gateway server about this relation by using the OpenAPI specification format, formerly known as Swagger. So in OpenAPI version 3, you can define relations between resources. For instance, here, I can say that the author property is actually a link to the author resource. If you create this Swagger OpenAPI version 3 definition, then you can use the Vulkan headers with any existing API. It will work because Vulkan supports this format, the OpenAPI version 3 standard. So, a quick comparison because we are in the GraphQL track. With Vulkan, you can push all the resources in parallel. With GraphQL, you cannot. It's a forced push. You create a big JSON document, and even if the client has already some relations in cache, everything will be downloaded again. With Vulkan, you can have a very, very granular cache, and the web browser will be able to cancel the push of resources it already has in cache, or it already has locally. But GraphQL, it's more than just a way to fix the over and the under fetching problem. It's a nice query language. It has a good type system, introspection mechanism, subscriptions, and a very, very good tooling. But actually, GraphQL is reinventing what is already standardized and existing in the REST world. REST has a web standard from the W3C called RDF, with implementation with format called JSON-LD Hydra that allows to create a type system, a web scale type system, and an introspection mechanism for any REST API. So it's already existing in REST. There is also OpenAPI, of course, to define your types and to give some introspection capabilities. For instance, the Mastodon API is a REST API supporting a very nice type system using JSON-LD and schema.org and as an introspection mechanism. And it's a REST API. Subscriptions, so you can refer to the Mercure protocol that introduces a subscription mechanism for REST APIs. And there are a lot of tooling. We will speak a bit about the tooling at the end of the talk, but in the long version of this talk, there is a lot of references to frameworks such as API platform in PHP or Graphity in Ruby, allowing to do REST API as easily than Apollo server, for instance, and the same thing for client-side tools. There is another thing that I want to say about REST and GraphQL. This guy, Edward Snowden, say businesses that make money by collecting and selling detailed records of private lives were once plainly described as surveillance companies. Their rebranding as social media is the most successful deception since the Department of War became the Department of Defense. Another guy, the creator of the web itself, Sir Tim Berners-Lee, says that The web is now dysfunctional with perverse incentives. The same guide, the guy that created the web itself, says that he is working on a very interesting new project built on top of RDF and JSON-LD called Solid. And his goal is to take the power away from monopolies like Google and the inventor of GraphQL, Facebook. And he still has hope that the internet can become something that serves humanity well, and that's not the case anymore. In the REST thesis of Roy Fielding, we can read something that is, the web is intended to be an internet scale, not only the Facebook servers, distributed hypermedia system. The internet is about interconnecting information networks across multiple organizational boundaries. So the web is a distributed system that has been created to allow, to mix, and to share, and to connect information from different people, different sources, different companies. Unfortunately, it's not how the web works anymore. Now, there is some big companies, including Facebook, Microsoft, Google, Apple, that are centralizing most of the data of most of the people in the world. And these companies are working with the NSA, with the PRISE program, to create mass surveillance programs. Facebook, the data of Facebook, has been used by Cambridge Analytica to manipulate the US election. Facebook is blocking the pages of the organizations that are fighting against ISIS in North Syria. They cannot use Facebook because it's blocked. It's possible only because of one thing, because the web is not decentralized anymore. And that to communicate, to have an audience, now you need to create a Facebook page. GitHub is blocking all Iranian users, including famous open source contributors, for instance, the Next.js framework, it's a Vue.js framework, is in trouble because one of their maintainers is Iranian and he cannot access to GitHub anymore. It also banned an app called Tsunami Democratic, a pro-Catalan independence app. And all of these blocking and bad behaviors have been made possible only because of one thing, because the web now is centralized. REST and the linked data movement has been created by the scientific community to serve humanity, while GraphQL has been created by Facebook to serve its business. The goal of REST is to use internet as a global database, while GraphQL is a very efficient tool, but for centralized information silos. The interoperability of REST is global and built-in, while with GraphQL you can do things, but it's still partial. And the web has been created for distributed systems, like the web. It's not the case of GraphQL because it's not what Facebook sells. Here is an example of the Mastodon API, an alternative to Facebook. And in this API, we have a domain name, social.example.com, serving some data, and with relations to servers, social.example.com, no, chatty.example.com, sorry, that are other servers owned by other companies, other individuals, other hardware. And they work together because this social network is distributed. And it's something, the link between several servers, that you cannot do with GraphQL. Actually, there are some pull requests open to add this kind of capabilities to the GraphQL format, but it has never been merged by Facebook. Why? I let you guess. So, this is Facebook, and this is what the web should be. And using REST, and Vulkan, of course, the goal of Vulkan is to fix the performance problem of REST, you can get the web in this shape, and it will be better for everybody. There is a new movement that is promoted by Mozilla, the creators of Firefox, called the D-Web for distributed and decentralized web. The goal of this movement, and Vulkan is a technology that has been created to serve the D-Web, is to decentralize and distribute the web again. And to do that, it uses Mastodon and web standards that has been created by the IETF and the W3C, including the REST, of course, and JSON-LD, schema.org, RDF, ActivityPub. Vulkan allows these standards and these applications to work as fast as GraphQL. While we are speaking about politics, as you can see in Paris, everything is blocked, there is no transport, and there is a very huge ongoing strike, and more than 800 French tech workers, including famous free software maintainers, members of the IETF, developers of the biggest companies, tech companies in France, are actually in strike, including me. Because we are against this proposal regarding the pension system by the French government, but also because we think that the concentration of the web and of the money in the hands of some people, a few people, is not something that serves the humanity, to quote Tim Berners-Lee. And so we are creating a new organization called On est là. It's a yellow vest slogan, .tech, with the goal to be able to change the web and to be able to stop the reform proposed by the French government. So if you are French, even if you are not, but it's not translated in English right now, you can read this call and sign it on this website. Let's speak a bit more about techniques. Who in this room is using Apollo server? No? Apollo is a very, very nice tool. But in this demonstration, I will use the Symfony framework and API platform. I will create a tiny app to be able to rate the talks of the speakers during this conference. So I will use PHP and API platform and Vulkan and a lot of other things that are provided by this framework that is very, very easy to use. So first, I run Docker Compose pool to install the framework and to have a development environment. Then I use a command line tool to generate an API. The API has a conference resource type related to sessions, related to feedback, the comments and the rates of the talks. With just these comments, I get a fully working web API with support for GraphQL. If you want to use GraphQL, it works, it's supported out of the box, but also with support for REST and JSON-LD and Vulkan without a single line of code. Then let's inject some data into this web API using a fixture system. And let's create a benchmark in JavaScript. The benchmark is easy. The goal is to retrieve all the data in database client-side. If you use Varnish, an HTTP cache server, and Vulkan, then it's 42 times faster than when not using Varnish and when not using Vulkan. If you don't want, if you already have Varnish and it's a good, it's a best practice in production, then just adding the Vulkan gateway server on top of your existing Varnish server will make your API 1.5 times faster than with Varnish alone, just by installing the Vulkan gateway server. And visually, here are the waterfall created by the data dependencies and the underfetching problem, and with Vulkan and HTTP 2 server push. When the data is needed, it is already there. You can find this demo available on GitHub, on my GitHub account. So, as a summary, Vulkan is fast and can be faster than GraphQL because data are downloaded in parallel. It's designed for the open web and as an ethical tool to decentralize the web again. It is very easy to deploy. It works with any existing API if you add an open API specification. It can be supported in minutes by any web API by using the Vulkan gateway server. And it's in the full version of the talk, but if you really like GraphQL, you can still use GraphQL client-side while using Vulkan server-side. Thank you very much.
So I don't think we have time again for questions, but it sounds like the full talk is definitely one to check out. So there was a lot of really interesting details in there.
Thank you.
And It sounds kind of glib, but I hope the protest works out for you guys. No, I mean, it's important stuff. So we're all a part of the solutions and the problems. So let's make sure we take these things seriously.